Wednesday, July 20th, 2016 session of the Cape Cod Regional Government Assembly of Delegates. This meeting is being recorded by others besides our normal recording person. So I will now call this meeting to order, and we'll begin a moment of silence to honor our troops who have died in service to our country and all those serving our country in the armed forces. Thank you, and we'll now stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The clerk will call the roll.
Ronald Bergstrom.
Here.
Lillian Green.
Here.
Christopher Kanega. James Killian.
Here.
Marcia King.
Here.
Edward Lewis.
Here.
Teresa Martin. Suzanne McAuliffe.
Here.
Deborah McCutcheon.
Here.
Edward McManus.
Here.
John Onan. Brian O'Malley.
Here.
Patrick Princey. Julia Taylor.
Here.
Linda Zern.
Here.
Mr. Speaker, we have a quorum with 88.39% of the delegates present, 11.61% absent.
Thank you. I'll need a motion to approve today's calendar of business if there are no changes to the calendar.
So moved. Second.
Moved and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, you should have received a copy of the Journal of July 6, 2016. Are there any additions or corrections to the Journal?
Speaker, I'll move adoption as approval as distributed.
Second.
Okay, moved and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
One abstention.
One abstention. Okay.
Abstention.
Two abstentions. Any more abstentions? Well, I don't see the commissioners here, so we will move beyond that. Are they having a meeting?
Yeah.
Well, they have one. I don't know if it's
they, I think they're in executive session going on some legal matters, Mr. Speaker.
Okay.
So they may be late.
Well, okay, we'll
skip. We're ready to go.
We'll skip that over them, and we will then move to number nine, our agenda for communications from Finance Director Mary McIsaac. And we have Bob Lutton here also.
Good afternoon, and thank you for letting us come before you today with really just some informational material. I have prepared a short memo for you about the status of capital projects. And today's is really an introduction to you from us of what we're going to do going forward for the Assembly and the Commissioners. We were with the Commissioners earlier. And I explained to them that, you know, the good components of a capital plan are the structure of it and the regular meetings and the presentations of for deliberation of needed capital improvements and capital repairs and purchases. So what I see in the history is that we've budgeted up until the last couple of years the capital inside of the operating budget. And we've successfully taken that out and created something separate and apart from that to be able to deal with our infrastructure and our capital needs separately from the operating budget, and to define what those needs are, prioritize them, and to budget appropriately, weighing in on, you know, what kinds of funding sources we have, and basically from year to year, the affordability of what's in the plan. And so in that regard, the plan going forward is somewhat of a living document, because it can change. You know, it's not set in stone, and from year to year, the plan can be amended and adjusted, and will come before you at budget time with an evaluation of the past projects and, you know, what their status and whether the projects were completed successfully, or there were you know, other circumstances with respect to each project individually. But what we'd like to start to do today, and what I've attached to this brief memo that I've prepared for you, is a chart of the last three fiscal years and what the Assembly and the Commissioners adopted for capital, what kinds of expenditures were set against them, if there were expenditures, and whether the projects are complete, ongoing, just beginning. So you could start to get a feel for the kind of information that we're going to bring to you and the discussions that we hope to have about capital. And we summarize that over the last 3 years that the Commissioners and the Assembly have authorized through borrowing almost $8.3 million of projects. In those last 3 years, we've spent over $2.7 million on behalf of those projects, and lots of them are ongoing. So really, it's just literature for you to read, something to start having you become familiar with what we'd like to come before you in terms of capital and talk to you about.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We've had a chance, I'm sure you've all had a chance to review these projects. Any questions? Yes, Ed?
Just Ed, excuse me, and welcome to, thank you for coming. Are we borrowing as we do a project, or are we borrowing that what was authorized to borrow and therefore paying interest on the total amount?
Well, the county hasn't borrowed in a long time. So all of the expenditures that you see and the authorizations that you see and the pages that are attached to the memo have not had any bonding. So there's been no bond proceeds for any of that. And those will be incorporated into the bond issue that is targeted for May of 2017. But directly to answer your specific question about a line, anything that's authorized, any project that's authorized that has spending, usually when you go to the bond market, you're going with the amount that you actually spent. And the logic behind that has changed over time. But some time ago, towns would authorize borrowing, and the minute they had the authorization, they would go to the market and they would bond that amount. Well, what happened was towns accumulated all kinds of what we're calling residual bond proceeds, which are the leftovers from borrowing an amount that was estimated to be the cost of something, and then it didn't cost that. And there were strict limitations on what those residual bond proceeds could be used for. So the rules about that have changed, and the rules about what you actually go to market to bond have changed. So in today's financial world for municipal governments, you look at what you've actually spent, and if your project is completed, that's what you borrow. Also, for the fact that you may have, even with all that planning and that all that exercise throughout some project, you have residual bond proceeds, the rules have changed about that. There's not a strict limitation as there was in the past, and what you can do with those residual bond proceeds now is you can move them to a project for which you could have borrowed for a term of at least the same number of years or more. So for instance, if you had a project and the term limit under the law for your borrowing was 10 years, you could move that into some other project for which you could also borrow for 10 years or more. So they've loosened the rules, but they've asked people to borrow what they're spending and not what was authorized.
Thank you. My concern always is that you forecast for capital expenditures for a fiscal year and find out, as an example, 2014, fiscal year 2014, we appropriated $3,691,000, to which date we've expended, $760,000.
Right. Well, and that year includes the dredge, which the RFP is out for, and that's, so that's a big chunk.
But we're still, this is 2 years ago.
Right.
Or 3 years ago.
Right.
And we're still.
Right.
50% of what we said we were going to do, we haven't done.
Right.
And completed.
Yeah.
And that always concerns me. It concerns me more when it wasn't being borrowed because it's appropriated.
Right.
And that's money that is out there, is not available for other uses because it's appropriated for specific capital projects. Now it's changed. Right. You're changing it, and that's good.
Right.
I appreciate that. I'm always concerned that we put out their capital projects for a fiscal year that we may or may not do.
Right.
And it means, I think, that we should when we're authorizing capital expenditures, for argument's sake, for fiscal year 17 or 18, we should have a pretty good handle that we're going to do it in 17 or 18.
Sure.
If we're not, then we should do it whenever we think we should do it.
Well, you would, and certainly that's true, but you would probably want to replace something that you might not be able to achieve with something that has a more immediate need, and you would be more successful in accomplishing, for sure. But these authorizations aren't really money in your pocket. It's sort of a credit line, because the clock doesn't start ticking on any liability until you've spent that money, really. So if you haven't spent it, we can go and spend on an authorization that's 10 years old, and we can still issue tax-exempt bonds for it if we've done that spending not 10 years ago, but today.
I understand. So. You understand where I'm coming from?
I do, exactly.
Thank you.
Right.
Anybody else?
You're welcome.
Walk me through this now, because I'm not necessarily a finance guy. Let's say we have an authorization to borrow $2 million for a dredge, which we sorely need, as Ed mentioned.
Yes.
The other one, its primary purpose is to be not functional for long periods of time. But so, you know, we go, and then next thing you know, Sears has a special on dredges, $2 million, and we want to buy it. Where does that $2 million come from? In other words, when we cut the check, we have the appropriation, but you say we don't borrow until we actually spend.
Right.
So we have to put the money up front. Where does that money come from?
So there's two places that the temporary funding source can be. You can pay for something in advance out of available funds, and that's allowed and permitted by law. Or you can issue bond anticipation notes, which are easily issued with the commissioner's signature and vote. And so those, you know, from the day that you know you need the funds till the day that those proceeds of that bond anticipation note are in your bank account, could be 2 weeks.
All right. Yeah, I'm familiar with bond anticipation notes, as Bob will tell you. We operated the RT, Regional Transit Authority, on them many years. But so what about a project that where you basically estimate the cost? Let's say you were going to replace a building or something, and you get the contracts come in for a certain amount of money, but I mean there's no guarantee, you know. So you basically do the same thing. You pay for that available funds, but you don't know. I mean, if you put a revenue anticipation note out there, but you really don't have a handle on what the ultimate cost will be. So do you wait until all the bills come in and then you do that?
You don't have to. For the larger projects, you phase in your funding. So you could issue three bands. You know, you could issue a band every 6 months to cover what you spent, or what you've budgeted, as long as what you're spending is close to your timeline for your spending.
Okay. And Mayor, have you done any kind of, do you have any kind of a handle on how much bond authorization the county or any municipality or any should have as a function of its total budget? In other words, you know, we have a budget of what, $30 million.
We have
several millions of authorizations out there and stuff. Is there any kind of formula that the state looks
at? There's a limitation for cities and towns, but there's not a limitation with respect to the county in the same framework as the cities and towns.
Oh, good. So we can just keep borrowing like you can. Well, we'll probably have to look at that. But all right. Does anybody have any more on this? Well, thank you very much. And do you have anything to add as far as how these projects are going to be? Are we looking at spending pretty soon, or?
With respect to the projects, that there hasn't been spending, a lot of them are relative to facilities and the complex, the questions on the complex redesign and the future of the buildings and the complex. So the spending is really on hold until, you know, there's a plan and it's been decided upon. Because obviously we don't want to allow spending for something that might have to be redone. That would be a waste of the county's funds. So with respect to all of that, there's varying reasons that those kinds of authorizations are on hold and those projects are not done. There's also other projects in the courthouse that, first of all, if we're being reimbursed because they're trial court occupied courthouses or other buildings, you would need DCAM's approval, that you're gonna get the reimbursement, and there's limitations on how much spending they'll reimburse in 1 year. Right now, we have a situation in Superior where there's mandated expenditures. So those expenditures count towards our limitation. So we don't want to enter into any projects that we'll spend money for that in another day we get reimbursed. But because the state has mandated certain spending and we reach the limit, the state won't reimburse us. So they're on hold till those dollars are freed up, so we'll get the maximum reimbursement from the state for whatever building it, you know, the repairs occur.
Okay. Deborah, did you have a question?
I do think this is a real good step in the right direction. It's been very, very confusing in the past to look at how these capital expenditures are handled. I'm wondering if it would be possible to put some timeline information in here, like the date the project was first approved. I know some of them are carried from year to year. And perhaps the estimated date of completion that was assigned to the project when it was first, because that kind of gives us a handle on how effectively we're running on our capital improvements.
Right, and when I talked about when we come before you in the budget season and we're deliberating the budget for the capital plan, the progress report that comes to you at that time will give you all of that information. It will be more of a progress report. This is really an introductory piece of material, so you start to see what we have in front of us, where it is today, not really in terms of progress, but the dollars that are either spent or unspent, and what the items look like. You know, what is in front of us says something that during a budget season was appropriated because it needed to be done.
Well, I do think it's very helpful. I just think that the timeline of it would be also
absolutely
great.
Absolutely.
Yes. Thanks.
You're welcome.
Okay, is there anyone else? Well, Jeff, Bob, you have something to add?
Just one quick thing, since I'm closing my time with the county, almost done, except for two projects that Jack had. And I just wanted to take the opportunity to thank you for your patience and understanding, especially in the first budget I did, which came in fine, but we had a lot of false starts, shall we say. But Janice is very helpful, as was John Ullman, and I just appreciate all of the help that you gave to me and understanding.
So, well,
may see you in another life, but maybe not here with the finance.
Well, we certainly appreciate your coming out of retirement as you have several times already and helping us out, because it made a big difference, and we're world improved from where we were when you first arrived. So
hopefully, did some things maybe not so much.
Okay.
But I appreciated all of your help.
Thank you very much.
Yes. Ed?
Bob, for your past service in Harwich, over here.
Right.
And your service to a neophyte assembly member, explaining the complexities and the confusion.
Yes.
I can't tell you how much I appreciate it.
Thanks for that.
All right, well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
We now move on to the communications and a presentation from the Cooperative Extension Health Department of Mosquito Control regarding gypsy moths, Zika virus, Powassan virus, and tick-borne diseases in the region. Oh my gosh.
Not really.
Some very good news. Hi, all. It's good to see you. I also wanted just to make sure that you all knew Marnie, who's the person behind the camera. I don't know if you all had a chance to hear that story, but Martin's doing a documentary on Larry's job. It's so interesting. Martin's a local documentary maker from Wellfleet, so I know it's unusual to have another camera in here, so I just wanted to make sure you knew what was going on there.
Thank you.
So I'm Mike McGuire, the Cape Cod Cooperative Extension Director, and so many of you probably saw on the front page of the paper, we're having a discussion about Powassan virus that was found on the Cape due to the research that my department did with in cooperation with Steve Rich, Dr. Steve Rich out of UMass Amherst, the Lab of Medical Entomology. Steve's been a collaborator with our department for a long time, and many of you know are familiar with the Lyme disease research that we've done and the tick research that we've done. And brought in a bunch of money from the Environmental Protection Agency and did those four poster deer studies, and you've heard talks about those. So last fall, when we were working with Steve, he had some graduate students come down, and we worked with them. He did a quick survey and found this presence of powassan in a couple samples that he took on the Cape. And during the winter, Steve and Dr. Rich and Larry and I had a long talk about what we should do with that information, because powassan is a very serious illness. If you contract it, you have a 1 in 10 chance of dying. And we started to see a few more cases pop up across the state. So we agreed to spend some county funds on doing a research project with Dr. Rich and his graduate students. And Larry's going to be here today to talk to you about powassan and the implications of what we found. We also have Deirdre Robertson from, and George is here too, great, both from County Health, to talk about the public health implication of this. So if you have public health questions, they'll be here to answer them. And Gabrielle from Mosquito Control is here, and she's going to also be available to talk to you about any mosquito-borne illnesses and what her program does. And I wanted to make sure that you get the chance to see all three of us together communicating them in front of you, because you know this is what we do on a daily basis behind the scenes. So, I also have to leave a little after 4:30, so Larry should be able to answer any of the questions that you have, or please follow up and email me. But with that, I'm going to turn it over to Larry, and Larry's also going to present on the gypsy moth outbreak here. Obviously, I think his phone is about to catch on fire from people calling. You know, it is a serious issue, and Larry's got some great data to share with you about that as well.
All right, just before you leave, how much, as far as outreach to the community on all these issues, I know you have a website. Do you have any printed material to distribute?
We have a lot of printed material, and to be frank, we're shifting to try to do a lot more electronic outreach. The powassan issue, it's going to be on, it was on Boston News last night, it's going to be on Boston News tonight. There's going to be a lot of people, it's a big splash media-wise, so there's going to be a lot of people calling and asking us, and certainly Larry and our front office staff will be answering questions, but there's also an electronic component where they can get answers on our website, and then we'll be posting through our Facebook page.
So if people go to the Barnstable County website and click on the Extension Service, they can get some of the information you're giving us today.
Absolutely. Or you can, you know, call Larry and make his phone catch fire.
Well, I'm not interested in me personally. I'm the people, you know, who are concerned about these issues.
Yes.
Doc, you're not speaking. Virtually.
Well, first we got a question.
Is looking for powassan now routine in the tick samples that are going out to Steve Rich's lab?
Larry's going to address that. You can request it. It's a relatively new test. There's a lot of extra labor involved, and it's a $99 extra to do it. But at least it's there. It's available to you. You really have to want to know it. But yes, it is available. So.
Okay. So that I take that answer as no. It's not being routinely tested for the specimens that are being submitted.
No, but Larry can elaborate on that. That's part, we would hope that's going to happen in the future. There's a lot of valuable information that would happen. We'd be able to collect if that happened. So.
Okay, well, thank you. You're up.
Well, good afternoon. Well, I can't think of a better way to spend a beautiful afternoon than having a robust discussion of infectious disease. Is that right? So thank you for the opportunity to spend some time with you on a couple what I think are timely and pertinent issues between tick-borne diseases and, of course, gypsy moth, what's been going on. So we'll start off today with powassan. When I send out or had sent out your pre-read materials, I anticipated your first question might be, what the heck is powassan, okay? And it's not so much a what. Ian, we need some help here.
Oh, it's not working.
Oh, that's why we have IT support. It's not so much a what, but a where. It's actually a real place, Powassan, Ontario. Powassan virus as a disease was first described in Powassan, Ontario in 1958, okay? So it's been diagnosed and known for some time. So here's a map of Powassan distribution. But Powassan, Ontario is right about up here, okay? So for a while, most of the cases were really confined to the upper central Midwest, principally Wisconsin and Minnesota. But in the last 15, 20 years, it did pop up on the East Coast, particularly in New York, in Eastern New York, the Hudson River Valley area. And we've seen a steady increase in reported cases over the last 10 years. So as we've been aware of this, we've been kind of watching over our left shoulder, wondering when and if it was going to make its presence known in New England and particularly here on the Cape. All right. Powassan is actually two different organisms, okay? They're related strains of the virus. The true Powassan is actually associated with the woodchuck tick, okay? It's around, but it's a tick that people don't really come into contact with very often. It remains in the burrow areas of woodchucks. One of the things that distinguishes this from our other tick-borne diseases like Lyme is transmission time. For Lyme, babesiosis, anaplasmosis, and relapsing fever, we basically have a 24-hour rule of thumb. If it's on you for more than 24 hours, the risk of transmission increases. Well, Powassan has a transmission time of 15 minutes. So that's a little bit of a game changer off the start. This is something similar to like West Nile virus. People can be exposed to this and absolutely not come down sick. And this has been documented that people in New York have been shown to have a lot of exposure, but very few cases. So it's quite rare, but a lot of people bump into it. When it does present itself as in its neuroinvasive form, it is very severe. Typically, the clinical presentation is encephalitis and meningoencephalitis, so brain swelling and spinal tissue swelling. The related species is deer tick virus, okay, and this is known in the medical world as Powassan lineage 2, so they're very closely related. And this one is associated with our friend the deer tick, and it basically has the same clinical presentation as Powassan type 1, lineage 1. So for all intents and purposes, Mass Department of Public Health just calls it Powassan. All right, what was brought to our attention last November was the fact that we've actually had 9 cases in the last few years in Massachusetts. And in talking with Katie Brown at DPH, they think the reason that they were finding this in the last 2 years, there's more awareness and people looking at people for West Nile virus. And so if it didn't become West Nile virus diagnosed, people started to consider other things and they fell upon Powassan. These 9 cases actually reside in 4 different counties, including Barnstable County, okay? So it is clinically here and present on Cape Cod. One of the things before we received this data, Mass Department of Public Health wanted to verify that this was due to exposure of tick bites in Massachusetts, that it wasn't people traveling to eastern New York and coming back and getting sick, but now they know. The onset of disease, May, June, so it shows that these nymph stage deer ticks are capable of transmitting this virus, as well as the adult stage ticks that start showing up in September and October. In every single case here, they all showed symptoms of encephalitis. This thing will land you in the hospital, sometimes for extended periods. I'm aware of one particular case where the guy was in the hospital for 6 months. On average, with this severe presentation, it's fatal in about 10% of the cases. Those people that survive this actually often have permanent neurological damage. So it's bad news all the way around. In this case, there were no fatalities with these 9 cases. All right, let me introduce you to my research colleagues at the Laboratory of Medical Zoology at UMass Amherst. This is Dr. Steve Rich. He's the director of the laboratory. This is his right hand, Dr. Guang Zhu. He is basically Master Yoder of this PCR analytical technique. He is infallible. and this is one of Steve's students, Emily. So we have had a, we have forged a solid partnership with this group. We've done a lot of good things. We've got some things that are going into press now for publication. So it's been a great two-way collaboration. All right. When this was first made aware to us that we actually had cases in the state, Steve and I talked about, let's do a quick survey. We thought, okay, we're looking for a needle in a haystack. Again, we're looking through this through the lens of West Nile virus. Gabby collects tons of mosquitoes, and she'll occasionally get a hit here and there. So we went out and took a peek. And at two locations, Falmouth and Brewster, the pools of ticks showed positive detects for powassan. So we thought, okay, we found two needles in the haystack. This is worth investigating. So what we did was make a more robust plan for this spring, where we identified six locations on the Cape ranging from Falmouth all the way out to Truro. So we wanted to go for a full geographic spread. And so Steve sent down students over a period of 4 weekends to these six locations to collect ticks. And when we analyzed them, we found powassan-infected ticks at 4 out of our 6 sites, okay? And the infection rates ranged from 2.5% all the way up to almost 10.5% out in Truro. So this actually surprised us at the level of infection of the ticks that we're finding in them. The other thing that's notable here is that if you look at the geographic distribution, excuse me, I've been talking a lot today. As Mike says, my phone is about to burn out. But finding this from Falmouth all the way out to Truro, this strongly suggests that this thing did not arrive yesterday or the day before yesterday or last year. This has been on the Cape for some time. We know the creatures this virus resides in, things like raccoons and skunks and possums and mice. Those things don't move very long distances. So this thing's probably been, and we don't know, but it may have been here 4, 5, 10 years, who knows. It just was flying under the medical radar screen. Steve also, while the students were here, he sent them out to the islands. And this kind of reinforces our thoughts about how long it's been here. On the vineyard, it was a detect in 1 out of 6 sites, but it was, you know, 9% infection rate, and 1 out of 1 on Nantucket. So again, it shows that this thing's been around for some time. All right, the next steps we want to engage on this is a retrospective surveillance. And what I mean by that is that when we have ticks tested and they extract DNA, that extract goes into the deep freeze. So that as we learn things about new diseases, we can go back into this archive of genetic material and see how far back can we find this. We did this exact same thing with relapsing fever, Borrelia miyamotoi. And when we went back into our archives, we were finding it in ticks going back to 2014. So it basically is a way that we can kind of map in time what is going on. We did share these data with Katie Brown at DPH. And Steve and myself and Katie had a conference call to kind of talk about the data, what we see, what they think about it. And this triggered actually some discussion that DPH is actually having discussions about conducting broader range surveillance for powassan virus, which would be a great thing to kind of drag them into and get some skin in this game. What we're proposing is expanded surveillance on Cape Cod, okay? I just received a request for proposals from Cape Cod Healthcare, their community benefits grant program. We've received funding for the last 3 years for different projects, and we have to meet a deadline for July 26th, which easily we'll meet. But our intention, after talking to Steve yesterday, we're gonna ask for funding to do full-scale surveillance across the Cape, all towns, multiple locations. We want to develop a high-resolution map of where this thing is and at what levels, okay? So that is our next steps. It doesn't change, really, the landscape for our current recommendations. It's nothing that we want to create a panic about. It means that we've gone from 4 tick-borne illnesses down to 5, okay? But the game plan remains exactly the same. We we again preach our three-point mantra: protect yourself, protect your yard, and protect your pets. So in terms of self-protection, certainly tick checks are in order. And I recommend and I preach strongly use of permethrin-treated clothing and footwear. In my experience in 5 years, this is the most effective tool in the box. And the word is getting out. I've been told by one of the major garden centers on the Cape that as we roll, as we get traction on our outreach program, they have seen their product sales double. The same with yard protection. There's one company on the Cape that does a lot of this work. And as we roll this out, they contacted me, brought me in to do a workshop for their employees, make sure they were doing things correctly. They actually added another truck and a person, and they're still not keeping up with demand. So I think our program is really taking hold, which is a good, good thing. I think that's the last slide in the deck here. So we can break here for questions that you may have.
Do you have any questions now on this, this virus? Yeah.
As the Bruce representative, just one quick question, because that is in this morning's paper as well.
Mm-hmm.
You had Brewster 1 and Brewster 2 up there.
Yes.
Do you know where Brewster 1 is, where they found the ticks?
Yes.
You want to tell me?
I chose to not give exact geographic coordinates because it would be misleading. I don't want to say we found it here and have people just, well, I need to avoid going to that place. We only sampled, you know, there are 11 towns we didn't sample, so I think it's premature to say we found it exactly here, but I chose to not put that in there by design.
I'm just curious, in Brewster, the other 11 towns, the people here can ask that question. But you choose not to tell people where in Brewster.
Not precisely. But the fact that we found it in Brewster, I think it's of note.
Yes, I just, I'd like to know where not to walk my dog.
That's why I'm not telling you, because I would be, I might be leading you into an area that's even hotter.
I walk where I haven't had a tick yet. Mm-hmm. I know another area where I used to walk and I'd come home and pick up three or four. So I chose not to walk there where I walk now.
In terms of tick population, the town of Brewster is actually tick nirvana.
Yeah.
That is the highest place year on year in our surveillance.
I'm so happy to hear that.
But you should be reassured that we have a game plan.
Oh, that's good.
Okay.
In fact, we covered that game plan at length with Gabby at your Brewster Conservation Day. We talked to a lot of people.
Yeah, that was. Did a great job.
It was a phenomenal event. Yeah. Every town should be doing that.
Yeah, that's a great job. Peter Johnson and Al Miners do that.
Mm-hmm.
Great. Thank you.
Okay, Pat, and then just we'll go.
Just a quick question. It'll possibly, and you maybe answer the gypsy moth question as well, even though we haven't gotten there. As far as the perimeter yard spraying and the spraying that's currently being done all over for the gypsy moth spraying, I can remember in the 80s when we had that outbreak.
Mm-hmm.
My brothers and I dressed up as gypsy moths at the parade down here, but we were all
I would like to see pictures.
Yes. We were all just, not only the gypsy moths were getting sprayed, but entire neighborhoods and people were getting sprayed. Now the chemicals that they used back then, I would think, are different from what they're using now. Can you tell me a little bit about the types of chemicals that they're using now for the
primary chemical for, and the chemicals for gypsy moth are not the same as for tick control.
Okay, so
two very different
for the tick
animals.
Control, what are the primary elements of those?
The industry standard of choice is a product called Talstar. It contains bifenthrin, which is something that's related to permethrin, so it's part of the pyrethroid family. And the product of choice, I think, that's mostly being used for gypsy moth control, same as winter moth, is Delegate, which contains the active ingredient spinosad.
Suzanne?
In terms of toxicity for children, I know it's important to balance the downside of the viruses and the bacteria that ticks carry, but also I think people are very concerned about when you spray and the permethrin on clothes and everything. Do you have any comments or recommendations about you know, if someone's going to spray their yard,
mm-hmm.
is it a children-friendly thing? Do you keep your kids out of the yard? How does that work?
I have some very in-depth discussions with soccer moms and soccer dads on that very point. In my workshops, I have a slide on permethrin toxicity. I call it my elephant in the room slide, because I'm telling you to put your kids in clothing treated with a synthetic pesticide. And the reasons for that, and I push it hard, is that if you look at the demographic distribution of cases of Lyme disease, kids age 5 to 9 are the highest incidence rate of Lyme in the state. So everything we've been doing up to this point in time is not working. It's time to come up with a better plan for protecting our kids. So to that end, I spend a lot of time talking to people about permethrin toxicity. And there's a lot that I draw upon. EPA has a position where the use of permethrin-treated clothing poses no harm to infants, children, pregnant women, or nursing mothers, okay? And the reason for that is that permethrin has very low dermal absorption, unlike some other pesticides, and whatever is absorbed is metabolized very quickly. National Academy of Sciences, which is not a lightweight organization, was wondering about the long-term exposure effects, and they did a study where they assumed people were in permethrin-treated everything 18 hours a day for 10 years. And when they rolled up that aggregate exposure, they saw absolutely no reason to expect an adverse effect. So when I look at what I consider to be relatively low risk of using this product, and I balance that against the consequences of one of these tick-borne diseases, for me, that is really easy math. And so I've been able to bring people a long way through this.
Thank you.
Has the medical community, and maybe Doc knows something about this, have they caught up with this virus? I mean, looked at treatments, looked at possible vaccines and stuff, or is this something that's sort of off the radar screen?
There's no vaccine for it. There's no treatment.
There's no vaccine or treatment. That's exactly right.
Is that because nobody's come up with one yet, or is it just
It's largely because it's a viral disorder, and most viral things we have a pretty tough time with. This is related to the neurotropic viruses that are largely seen in the Far East, Asian encephalitides and meningitis, and basically care is really pretty supportive when it happens. So a vaccine is possible, but it's somewhere down the line. Mm-hmm. And vaccines, of course, depend upon there being enough commercial applicability, sure, that the manufacturer is going to make big bucks. That's not true in this disease yet, so I wouldn't hold my breath.
Well, they come up with the vaccine, they can always charge us $100,000 a shot.
What we tell people is that you want to prevent the tick bite in the first place at all costs. Treat this like hand-to-hand combat, basically. But to your question, we did have a press release prepared with this information. And one of the points of distribution today was with Robin Lord, who's the Director of Communications at Cape Cod Healthcare. So she is pushing this out through their network.
Okay, there's no more questions on that. Deborah?
I have a couple of questions. I too am a dog walker, and I spend a lot of time in the forest, and I'm in Truro, so I have some interest in your discussion there. Can you tell me, a lot of people think that walking along the beaches and the near shore is a much safer place to walk than the forest. Is there any real logic to that?
Beaches are perfectly safe. That's not tick habitat at all.
So it's not tick habitat. So yeah. That's okay. And that's kind of both helpful and
If you look at optimal tick habitats, shade, leaf litter, right, High humidity, those are the environmental requirements for ticks to make their living.
Right. Now, how about some of the measures that people use for their yards, like the treated cotton for keep the mice from getting deer ticks?
The Daminex tick tubes. That's in my hall of fame of serpentology. It is the biggest waste of money that I can think of. And because there were two very good independent studies done on that product, and they both demonstrated that those tick tubes have absolutely no impact on deer tick populations at all.
Well, it's a great marketing idea, though.
It's spot marketing, isn't it?
Mice are all comfortable in their little nests with no bugs at all.
Needless to say, the manufacturer, EcoHealth, has taken me off their holiday greeting card list.
You know, it's interesting, though, because right now in Truro, there's a dispute going on between the dog walkers and the Audubon over the piping plovers and the lease terns. And the dog walkers are of the opinion that they're much safer from all of these tick-borne illnesses if they're walking, for example, at Cornhill or other of the beaches. And the Audubon is not so happy with that because they're out there, you know, putting up their fences and trying to protect the plovers. And there is a view among the public that the plovers might not be quite so important as dying from a tick-borne illness. So I guess you don't want to comment on that.
Well, I've had this conversation with the people at Sandy Neck Beach Park, which is a neighborhood I work for. That's where, with the help of Gabby and her people, we discovered the first established population of Lone Star tick on the Massachusetts mainland, and that new tick now kind of owns that real estate.
Right. Now, you got to notice this presentation had nothing to do with the Lone Star tick. Are we not concerned about them anymore now that we have this other disease?
We are concerned. It depended how much time you had. Yeah. I can sit here for a day and a half and talk to you about a lot of things. But we can do an update on Lone Star at some point in time because we are trying to gather evidence about where this is spreading outside of Sandy Neck, and it is significant in a number of different ways. So.
Well, I appreciate it, and I thank you for your work. I hope you're wearing a pyrethrin treated clothing.
Year-round.
Year-round, good. Thank you.
All right, Doc.
Mr. Datsis, can you, you referenced pyrethrin-treated clothing and foot gear. Mm-hmm. Are there products that can be applied to a pair of jeans, pair of shoes? Are there commercial products available?
Sure. You can buy these products now. I convinced all the major garden centers on the Cape to carry pyrethrin products that you can treat your clothing and footwear with. When I came here and saw how effective it was, that was the frustrating thing. If you knew about it, Eastern Mountain Sports was the only place that had it. The garden centers have now emerged and developed as a major outreach partner for our program. So not only are they stocking the right products, but they bring me in to do workshops and different events at stores. So it's been a really good arrangement.
Great, thank you.
Lily?
Thank you. Something you just mentioned, you said that you wear pyrethrin-treated clothing year-round.
Absolutely.
I don't have a dog, but I'm a walker, and I've been walking for many years. And I walk in the woods, I walk on the beach. And a lot of people in my town, Wellfleet, do walk within the National Seashore. I'd like to ask you about explaining that, about wearing the clothing year-round, and also about the dangers and precautions when you spray clothes. I was reading about that as well.
Sure, and it's significant for you because I think, if I'm not mistaken, Wellfleet's the highest incidence rate of Lyme of any town on the Cape. So treating clothing is easy. I mean, it's basically putting your clothes over like a porch rail, shoes on a deck, treat them until they're slightly damp, let them dry. What I also do with my jeans, unless I'm wearing pre-treated clothing from a company called Insect Shield, then I'll turn them inside out and treat the inside from the knee down in case ticks come in from underneath. Got to kind of think like a tick in these situations.
And you think it's important to do this year round?
Well, here, look at it this way. Your winters here on the Cape are very mild, even though you sometimes think they're harsh. If you look at the reported cases of Lyme disease by month, they go from January to December. So anytime you get temperatures above freezing and a break in snow cover, you're gonna have tick activity.
Because they're hungry.
They are.
All right, anybody else out there? Ed,
I've noticed the last couple of years, during the summer, at a number of the arts and crafts fairs, there's a Cape Cod Natural Remedies. He was selling some flea and tick repellents. I wonder if the efficacy of using those products, and whether you've tested them at all.
I steer people away from those type of products at all costs. The big difference between a repellent that like DEET or something, they're EPA registered. If they say on the label repels ticks and mosquitoes for 6 hours, there are data on file to support that claim. These all natural products, they're EPA registration exempt, meaning they don't have to supply any data to support their work at all. And the other thing is, I investigated those active ingredients. If you really look into it, a number of them are actually known human allergens, and there are documented cases of those products interacting negatively with sunscreens. So I wave off.
Let me ask you one more question. If you're a parent, let's say you have a child, maybe 10 years old, and you find that they have a tick on them, and maybe the tick has been there for a while. Mm-hmm. I found ticks on me that look like they've been there for years. But so what advice would you give to that parent as far as, I mean, you know, for some reason I brush it off. Now that I hear from you, I'm not going to be so cavalier about it, but I mean, some people fly into a panic and they think, oh my God, should they have that tick tested?
I think it's a good idea. And I look at ticks with people to see if there's any signs of engorgement. Has this thing been attached for some period of time? The benefits of getting a tick tested is that you have hard data. So if you have a kid or even yourself and you get a tick bite and you're not feeling well, now you can go into your doctor's office and say, hey, I was exposed to this, but maybe I was also exposed to this, because in our research over 5 years, we found that on average, 8% of the nymph stage ticks that we evaluated, 8% are co-infected, meaning they're packing Lyme plus one of these other things, and you can come down with more than one of these diseases at the same time, which really complicates diagnosis.
All right, so you would take the tick, you would remove the tick, obviously, put it in a little, you know, sandwich bag or something like that?
Yes.
Bring it to, where would we?
No, you would go to tickreport.com.
Okay.
That's the UMass laboratory of medical zoology. There's an online submission process, and which is very easy. Plus, if you get stuck, there's an online chat function that they monitor constantly. They get the tick, and when after they receive it, you get your test results in 3 to 5 business days.
Okay, good. Well, that's interesting to know. All right. Well, I guess we got one more here from Julia.
I'll just comment. While you were speaking, I did order from a leading online retail company.
Good for you.
Spray, and it will be delivered tomorrow.
Oh. All right. See that? Basically, the success of many.
I should be in sales, huh?
Well, now we have other critters to discuss, so we'll move right along then to the next.
Let's talk about something that does infect your diseases, but can be equally annoying. Our friend the gypsy moth. And it's hard to see with all the lights on here, but this is just complete defoliation, which is something that people have been seeing more and more of. These are from the outer cape that was hit particularly hard this year. And as the trees are completely defoliated and the caterpillars maturing, and you see this happening a lot, this is when my phone starts ringing off the hook. Like, what is going on? What are these things? Why are they here? What can we do to get rid of them? So it's been an interesting 3 or 4 weeks of teaching people the ins and outs of forest ecology. One of the things that I was able to get from conservation and recreation are data on actual acres defoliated by gypsy moth. If you look at this, they do aerial surveys in the middle of the summer after the gypsy moth season. And in 2015, you can see that on the Cape, particularly the upper Cape into the mid Cape, was hit particularly hard, okay? When you compare that to 2016, I've had these data for about 24 hours. Certainly, the outer Cape was hit particularly hard this year, but you look at southern Plymouth County, Bristol County, southern Worcester County, this thing has really ramped up hard. And when they supplied me the actual acres data, acres defoliated, it was pretty staggering. In Barnstable County, last year, there were about 14,000 acres defoliated. That over doubled this year, 34,000 acres. If you look at the state, just under 40,000 acres last year. This year, 350,000 acres. So somebody made a reference to gypsy moth problems in the 1980s. That's what this looked like in the 1980s. We're kind of back to that point. So needless to say, a lot of people have been calling about should they get gypsy moth traps, and because the moths are flying right now, and I tell people that the gypsy moth traps are basically a monitoring tool for USDA, complete waste of money, but it, for some people it's kind of a feel-good exercise. Banding of trees to prevent larvae from going up or down, pretty useless. You're not going to have an impact on a population with that. Some people have asked about, what if I scrape those egg masses off the side of my tree? Again, people want to kind of take a little bit of vengeance on these things. That has no material impact on populations, because when these things hatch out in the spring, they're little, they spin a silk thread, they can float onto the wind, and so even if you clean up your yard, depending which way the wind is blowing, these things can come back into your neighborhood from 5 miles away, okay? So local intervention other than spraying your trees is kind of a waste of money. All right, why is it a problem now? This thing actually has been kept in check for a long time by this fungus in the genus Entomophaga, okay? This thing was initially released back in 1910 from isolates in Japan, and it just failed to establish. So people kind of dismissed it, gave up on it. But about 70 years later, some people thought, let's give it another try. So they reintroduced it in 1989 in Connecticut, and it not only took hold, but it just ripped through the entire Northeast and established itself. So it's here, and this has been a great suppressor, sustainable suppression of these populations. It's kind of pushed gypsy moth into the background for a number of years until recently. In the last 2 years, we've had very dry springs. That interferes with the ability of the fungus to become activated. So last year, being so dry, it let gypsy moth kind of get out of the blocks, lay a lot of eggs, and that carried over to this year and another dry spring. So what we really need is next year, next spring, to actually have a reasonable amount of rainfall, get this fungus going again and push it into the background. When this thing is active, it's easy to see. Those are gypsy moths hanging. They're basically dissolving from the inside, okay? When these fungal spores come in contact with the caterpillar, they germinate and kind of invade the caterpillar and dissolve it from the inside, kind of like invasion of the body snatcher sort of thing. So it'll form more spores. Yeah, it's actually pretty cool from a bug person standpoint. Yeah, you can appreciate it. But we're hoping that this thing will come back and put this whole thing back into balance. Now, it hasn't happened yet, so one of the things we're looking at is, what are the implications of continuous defoliation? Well, certainly wildfire risk kind of comes to mind, because you lose your tree canopy, you dry out the forest floor more easily. So I actually had a nice discussion this morning with Dave Cellini, who's the state fire warden, and he kind of put it in perspective for us that this isn't clear and present danger necessarily. The primary driver of wildfires to occur is really drought. That's really what's amplified this to date, the risk of wildfire. But defoliation is a second risk driver, and unfortunately for us, we have these things working in tandem. So we have according to their risk index, we're at a moderate risk, but that risk is climbing each and every day. So the what would they call the small ground fuel, the twigs and the leaf litter, that is completely dried out, but that doesn't trigger the biggest fires. Their concern is really the large ground fuel, logs on the ground that are 3 to 6 inches in diameter. When those things dry down to about 20% moisture level, that can generate some very deep fires that are hard to put out. The other thing that is, that we're looking at or thinking about is forest health. We know that successive defoliation from gypsy moth will lead to a decline in acorn production, okay? And that has implications for forest regeneration. When oak trees are really hammered by gypsy moth, along with the winter moth and crypt gall wasp, it will take maybe 10 years for that tree to fully recover once those stresses are removed. And there are other implications about acorns, okay? Acorns actually happen to be the primary fuel that drives the tick-borne disease ecosystem. So while you all thought we were switching from ticks to gypsy moths, it all circles back to ticks, okay? Because what we do know is that acorn production, mouse populations, and tick populations are all linked, okay? Everything is connected. So what we are trying to consider, what are the implications of a very small acorn crop? We know through a number of research findings that when you have a bumper crop of acorns, you get an explosion in the mouse population the next year, and then next year you see a resultant increase in tick populations. When you have a very small crop, we're going to get a crash in mouse populations. But there are some ways I'm thinking about this that imply that you actually could see an increase in the risk of tick-borne diseases. So I'm waiting for Rich Osfeld. He is an ecologist at the Cary Institute of Ecological Studies in New York. He is the world's expert on the Lyme disease ecosystem. And I contacted Rich, and he sent me back from an email from a remote location in Kenya. So we're going to chat about this, but he'll be back in the country next week. So it's good to have a resource like Rich in our pocket to discuss things like this with. And I think that is it. Yes.
Okay, thank you. Now, do you have any questions or concerns about these critters? I know that I have several trees that have been defoliated first by the winter moths and then by the gypsy moth. And right now, as I left my house, I have moths flying all over the place. It's like, it's amazing how the concentration is in certain areas. But you're telling me that they don't necessarily kill the tree.
Oh, no, they successive years of defoliation. Conifers, like, they like white pine and they will feed on pitch pine. And you get a full defoliation in 1 year in a conifer, that tree is hurt badly. Oak trees, hardwoods in general, can take 2 or 3 years of heavy defoliation before it kind of makes them weaker and more susceptible to diseases and other things.
Well, I mean, it's just because for homeowners, it's expensive to cut down a tree. In other words, if you lose a beautiful tree, I mean, not only do you lose the tree, but you also have to hire someone to come in and cut it down and carry it away. And it's kind of a bad experience, but so we have to pray for rain, is what you're saying, in next spring, pretty much.
Okay. Yes.
I'll get hands up all. I'll start at the far end with Dr. O'Malley.
Thank you, Larry. Is there introduction of entomophaga planned? Is that done by spraying? I mean, you say it reestablished in Connecticut. Was that facilitated by us?
Yes.
It was.
Yes, we did it.
Is there any plan for that to happen here?
It spread from Connecticut. It's here. It's here.
We don't plan to augment it.
We don't need to.
You don't need to. Okay.
We don't need to. It's here, and when we have the right environmental conditions, it'll push gypsy moths into the background like it has been for a number of years now.
Okay. Who do we got? We got Ed.
Spray our trees every year. We have a company come in, they spray it, everything. And we haven't had a problem. Lots of moths flying around right now, but they don't cause it. The caterpillars cause the problem.
Correct.
And the spraying seems to work. The biggest problem we've had that we had, they're trying to work on that with the oak trees, is that wasp you talked about.
The crypt gall wasp, yes.
Yeah, that, and so they have to drill into the tree and put some stuff in there that several places.
And even that's not been proven.
Well, it seems to have worked.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, people are kind of guessing at this one.
Well, but it has stopped some of the distress, because some, when
we called these people to come out, the limbs were just falling off.
Sure, we're hoping to see what happened with gall wasp on Long Island years ago. It was a big problem for about 10 years, and then it just disappeared. There was a parasite that came in and took care of the wasp.
But it's, to go along with what Ron said, if you go out and you're aggressively treated, mm-hmm. do the best you can.
Well, it's the only tool in the box we have.
Yeah, both spraying for the juices and everything. You can say it because it costs a lot more to cut down a tree than it does to treat it. So mm-hmm. it's not really that bad.
Okay. Just briefly, what states do the gypsy moths do the major defoliation at?
From the point they hatch out as little teeny tiny larvae to the point they are just about to become a pupa. Believe it or not, the appetite of a gypsy moth is enormous. The female moths, the caterpillars are bigger than the males, okay? And if you look at what a single female gypsy moth caterpillar consumes later in the game, 12 square inches of foliage per day, okay? When you look at the entire life cycle from hatch to maturity, each caterpillar has consumed a square yard of leaf area.
I got an additional problem. We're beekeepers. And mm-hmm. So, of course, if you add any chemical spraying to the trees and stuff, it's met with some opposition.
Sure. I mean, if you have a tree in bloom, there have been big bee kills from people applying spinosad to trees that were in bloom.
Okay, but if they're not, so basically, that's the issue, is if they're in bloom, you should
exactly. avoid that.
Okay.
I had the opportunity to drive to Connecticut last week and drive through Rhode Island. They're literally the whole side of one, it's interesting, one side of the highway is defoliated, almost the whole state of Rhode Island,
mm-hmm.
and then you go into Connecticut. So it's not just the Cape that is suffering. So we have to hope that they have fungus.
No, I talked with my counterpart in Connecticut, and he's praying as much for rain as I am.
Jim?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This last slide here, you mentioned, Matt, with the mice being a problem. They're sort of a host for this virus that the ticks...
Sam Telford at Tufts University believes that Powassan virus can reside in mice. I haven't seen any data to show that, but mice seem to be involved in every single thing involving ticks and disease. But it is known that possums and skunks and raccoons are major players in this.
Is much known about where that virus originates?
No.
Ontario.
No, it was first described medically in Ontario, but it could have came from Manitoba, I don't know.
Worried, no doubt.
Deborah?
Just a little follow up there on the acorns, mice, and ticks.
Mm-hmm.
So if you don't have the gypsy moths get rid of the acorns by getting the trees that make the acorns, right? So is the solution to this problem to get rid of the oak trees and the mice?
I don't think that's necessarily sound ecological thinking. But we do know that it all works in tandem. As acorn production goes up, mouse populations go up, gypsy moth populations go down because mice love to feast on those little pupae hanging on the side of a tree. To a mouse, a gypsy moth pupa is like movie theater buttered popcorn, literally.
So. It's a little overwhelming. Thank you again. It seems like it's a task without a solution.
It's a task that can be managed.
Yeah. Okay. Yes.
Thank you. So, can you speak a little bit about how long we should see the moths, and is there anything at all that, I mean, you said that there's basically nothing you really can
do. No, the moths, what you see flying right now with the male moths, the female moths are sitting on the side of a tree calling their hearts out for a boyfriend. And so once they finish laying eggs, and so they'll be dying off fairly shortly.
Okay.
But they're not doing any damage, per se.
Okay, thank you. Well, you know, you indicated earlier, we can get some of this information online. I know people are concerned all over the Cape now about the virus.
We haven't posted the Boston material online as yet.
I'm sure you will. Okay, thank you.
All right, very good. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Larry.
I noticed that the two of the commissioners are here, so I'll go back to number eight on our agenda, the Communications and Board of Regional Commissioners.
That's us.
Anything substantive to tell us?
Chairman.
Mr. Chairman.
Are you done with the ticks? I mean,
Mr. Speaker, excuse me.
Skipped over us to go to you?
We have a representative from the mosquito control. I don't know if you want to just, if there are any questions regarding that for that lady there.
Okay, that's where I figured they were headed.
So, thanks.
Microphone.
Oh, sure. The county health and the extension service worked closely with us, and they asked me to come in today. We've been working with the county health department on a Zika fact sheet that they are distributing that will give information. I know that the mosquito control is kind of old news, and I recognize a lot of faces, and I've told my story a lot. I have crews out there that are doing the same thing that they've been doing, control mosquitoes in all of your towns. The news has been Zika virus, so we just like to get the information out there. The people on Cape Cod don't need to be concerned. We've been doing surveillance for the species of mosquito that might be carrying this disease in the Northeast for the past number of years. It was first, Asian tiger mosquito is the only species in this area that would be capable of transmitting Zika virus. Asian tiger mosquito has not been found on Cape Cod. They have a population in New Bedford that they've been picking up since 2008, so we've been doing surveillance specifically to see if that mosquito was here. It's not here. There's no mosquito on Cape Cod, as far as we know, that can transmit Zika virus. The concern here is the same old concerns I always talk about. West Nile virus, Larry mentioned it, it's very similar to Powassan. West Nile virus, we've gotten our first positive, which is about a month earlier than we've been getting it the past few years in Falmouth this last week. And the message is the same. The mosquitoes that carry West Nile virus are the mosquitoes that lay their eggs in man-made containers. If you go around your yard after it rains and dump out all of the water in those containers, you're doing what you can to control those mosquitoes. They don't fly very far, so that's the best thing you can do. And repellents, you know, to avoid mosquito bites. So, quick, that was mosquitoes in a nutshell.
Thank you.
Give them the days of hat, will you?
Okay, give them what?
The days of hat.
Oh, okay, so, thank you, Commissioner. The one thing that I should mention is that mosquitoes will lay their eggs hatch, they go through their larval stage, pupal stage, they're flying adults in 7 days. So a small container of water in your yard, left with water in it for 7 days, can create hundreds of mosquitoes.
Thank you. Thank you, George. Do you have anything to add to this?
I'll just add one little brief thing to the update. Many of you know that the governor had in his budget a stipulation for folks who are seeking relief from long-term effects of Lyme. He actually added to his budget something that would have made it more difficult to obtain that and be covered by insurance. On behalf of the county and as county health officer, we contacted every one of the Cape legislators as well as the Senate President and the Speaker of the House in opposition to that, and I believe that it's on its way back to the wording that was there. Basically would have allowed, does allow, will allow a doctor to prescribe antibiotics beyond that short period that they're normally covered for. And this we thought very important because the language that the governor placed in there would have been so specific that many of those specialists that were indicated in his revised wording don't really take Lyme patients for very long. And there are other good doctors out there doing some very good research on things and very knowledgeable about the use of antibiotics in this case, these cases, that would be prohibited. Well, they could prescribe it. However, there would be no coverage for it. So that, along with one other brief update, as you heard, the Zika sort of scare, we realize that this risk is pretty low for our area, but the Regional Emergency Planning Committee, in conjunction with Gabby and in conjunction with Extension and others, have put together a flyer which we are just in our final draft phase of. We're about to translate it to other languages also for the general public, very much like what we did with Ebola. Because when Ebola hit, of course, that was such a scare. We had outreach to a lot of the first responders. And in this case, we know that the threat level is much lower, but DPH presently gets 50 calls a week on Zika. So we know that the interest is still high there, the lack of understanding and knowledge is high, so we're continuing our outreach in conjunction with the other departments you heard from. That's it. Didn't want to show up first and bury the lead story, because I'll tell you, the Powassan is definitely the lead story.
George, as far as I know, there's been a big debate about Lyme disease with doctors on both sides as to whether it's chronic. It seems to be that, do you feel that they have a handle now on this?
I think there'll always be the controversy, but I would urge any of you who are sort of on the state side of the fence that says, no, there's really no controversy, this is just something vague that goes on for years, people have fibromyalgia or something like that, I would urge you to look at some of the research. Some of the research that Dr. Arcot has done down at Johns Hopkins University, something called a SLICE study, where he actually looked at people who had symptoms, the bullseye rash, had to be a bullseye rash, been treated with antibiotics, and for 2 years followed them quarterly, and reports on the percentage of people who look and they say, it's in the rearview mirror, I'll never see anything about Lyme again, and a significant percentage who don't go that way, that after 2 years they start reporting some symptoms, or 6 months, long after the antibiotics have stopped. So I'll tell you that personally, in viewing the literature, I'm not a doctor, I do fancy that I can read, I believe that the literature and the scientific, the medical studies point towards something going beyond that. And I would doubt there's anybody in this room who probably doesn't know somebody who has had some extended sort of symptoms of Lyme long after they've been treated with antibiotics first, bullseye rash is gone, they hardly remember that, but some symptoms persist. I believe something is going on.
I have a nephew who was diagnosed with Lyme after he'd gone through a lot, you know, he had vague symptoms and nobody could figure it out. Finally, he was diagnosed with Lyme probably 5 or 6 years ago. He's still on some kind of medication.
The diagnostic tests are not really good in it. There's some work being done on that. However, I believe there'll always be the controversy, even among some of the members of the task force that the county has, the Lyme and Tick-Borne Disease Task Force, there is some controversy. But I do think that it was appropriate for me as your county health officer to make the comments on the governor's sort of changes to the legislation, because there are a lot of people down here that would have made it more difficult to continue their regimen.
Yeah, Ed.
Quickly on a public health note, I noticed when Gabby was getting up and sitting down on the back of her t-shirt, she said something about, are you a blood donor? I just wanted to note that this Wednesday, Cape Cod Healthcare at the Mid-Cape Moan Center is doing a blood drive. They're running significantly low of certain types of blood groups, and people are being encouraged to donate blood if they physically can do so.
Doc?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Just to expand a little bit on what Director Hoyfeller has said about long-term Lyme, I think pretty clearly that the crux of the controversy is not whether there are people who certainly have long-term chronic symptoms, but whether those symptoms represent active infection or whether those represent some kind of response. And that's really where the controversy lies. clearly there are people who run into difficulty, and there are, even some of the people who do believe that it's a chronic infection recognize that certain of the antibiotics have anti-inflammatory properties, and that may be due to that. That's the essence of the scientific conundrum.
Absolutely. Because the infection, even in somebody who has long since thought it was an error of mirror, they can't pick up the organism in the blood. But what's really scary is some of the research after they've passed and have done some sections of tissue that you'd say, whoa, how did it get into that tissue? Now, things like cartilage, and you go, wow.
I'll never look at bugs again.
You
my
never
life
will.
Goes to dreaming of bugs coming at me from all different directions.
Larry just scares the hell out of everybody, and we just sort of educate them so they don't have to be scared.
All right, well, thank you, Judge. I'm glad you're on the on that case.
Thank you.
Okay, well, I guess now we can move on to the commissioner. Sorry about that.
Don't turn the camera off. That's the only reason why I came here.
It's on.
I got to get this free press.
What? You're not running for anything now.
I'm always running for something. You know that.
Running for
anything. That's nothing. I got you on tape saying you're spray.
I do.
Welcome.
Thank you. I didn't think we'd get here. Things kept going on and on, but here we are. We did vote today to establish an other post-employment benefits liability trust fund. Many towns have already done this. It's other than attempting to try to pay those benefits out of the operating budget year after year after year really doesn't work. So we're doing the same thing. We're going to establish a trust fund. I know some towns actually, when they did do that, they actually changed the benefit for some retirees, particularly the percentage that towns paid toward health insurance. Some that were paying 75% dropped it to 50% or something like that. But we're just simply at this stage establishing the trust fund, and we'll see where it goes from there. Mary McIsaac did give us a report on the capital projects year to date. That you have those? Yeah. So we're going to have that, so there's no need for us to talk about it. You'll have it, we'll have it, and then at some point in time, we will be discussing it anyway when it comes to the budget. And George, he already gave you the same report we had. And the only other thing we discussed was, and you may probably already know, that the Cape Cod Commission undertook a reclassification of their employees, of the positions of the Cape Cod Commission. And we decided it was time for us to do the same thing. Not that the jobs don't in any way relate to one another, their jobs are totally different from the jobs at the county, but we can still follow the same process in the sense of keeping our employment structure pretty much as similar as we possibly can, so that we don't end up with two different groups of people operating off two different basic principles of operation. So ours won't necessarily conform to it, but it will conform to the structure. Leah.
Just the only action that you missed was the approval for the Pan Mass Challenge to use our facility out here, and the only reason why I want to update you with that is to give them a little press time. I think it's going to be, I know it's going to be Sunday, October 7th, 2016, and it's the 36th.
August 7th.
I'm sorry, August. What did I say?
October.
No.
August 7th.
It's August 7th, 2016. It's a Sunday, and it's the 36th annual Pan Mass Challenge. The Jerry Fund Cancer Research.
Is that they picked out because it's going to be the hottest day of the year and it's early on?
I have no idea. I don't run, so run is a bike thing.
Bike thing.
I don't bicycle either. So
reclassification oftentimes results in people's salaries being adjusted. Is that going to be the case here?
The situation that we did today, we actually voted in and approved the Cape Cod Commission's reclassification study. The only really difference in their and included in their plan is they have a merit system now, so that when an individual caps out, if you will, at the step that they are categorized under,
and they cannot move into a different category. They basically, like, what's the term? Is it stepped out? Is that what they use?
Like maxed out.
Maxed out. They're going to implement a merit system, and we authorized it. We read the plan, looked at the plan, approved it, and we authorized the executive director of the Cape Cod Commission to implement that. And the only changes that we're going to be doing is probably adjusting our personnel manual to reflect that. And Jack is, with his staff, looking now at the reclassification of, I guess I'll use the word, general county employees, to see how that might fit in our plan. We had not taken any action for the general county employees. The only action was taken today was for the Cape Cod Commission.
Is that going to have any immediate effect on the fiscal 2017 budget?
Absolutely not. Okay. Everything that we voted in the fiscal FY17 budget was under an anticipation of this plan moving forward. It was actually on our desk, and we were reviewing it when we were reviewing the budget, and I was the one that asked that it be tabled until our new executive director could, our new executive could look at it, because Jack wasn't here then, and so all we did today was approve it.
Okay. Any questions for the commissioners? I'll start with Ed.
Just a cautionary. You know, school committees and schools all operate with both lanes and what's the other?
Steps.
Steps and lanes, and people max out and stuff like that. But we also, in one of the cost of living increases, which are over and above that, so you're getting two. And if you end up doing it for one and put in merit, you're going to end up, and merit is, it supposedly is in everything, but you just be aware that once you do that for one group, other groups are going to, you know, we're lucky as far as the county is concerned, we don't have police and fire. Towns do have police and fire, as well as education, and then they have the union, so all of that stuff. So when you're doing that, and I commend you for doing it, just be aware that that has a way of going across the whole breadth of the employment.
Well, actually, the county already has that process in place, that if a person's been in a position for 3 years, they've maxed out, then each 3 years, their position is reviewed with them. I don't have any data to say, have those ever been changed or have they ever been upgraded? I'm sure in some instances they have, but we can ask the county administrator for that information.
Yeah, Suzanne?
I'm going to be even a little stronger than Ed Lewis was. I was very concerned this budget cycle that the commission chose to give salary increases to its employees when the rest of the county had essentially a pay freeze. It was my understanding that steps are traditionally used because you start people at low-paying salaries, and it's used to catch people up to a higher salary more quickly, and that's traditionally why you have steps in a contract. And you're right, people get steps, and they get a cost of living, and you can have 5, 7, 12 steps, whatever the contract calls for. And now you're going to add merit to those who have maxed out of their steps, so you're going to continue the double increases, cost of living, and merit, because from the people who currently get merit now, which are 14 or 15 administrators, they get their merit. So I'm just very concerned that the commission, Cape Cod Commission, because they have money and they are a separate entity from the county, sort of, but not really, that they are now going to be making sure that their highly paid salaried personnel are going to get increases that are going to be out of step with the rest of the county. That's just my two cents.
Okay. I know I've gone over this before when we had the debate, but, you know, I like to encourage, you know, public employees. I think that they perform a good service. The whole idea that people mentioned the cost of living increase. Well, the cost of living increase is a measure to compensate for inflation. So theoretically, if you just got a cost of living increase for 10 years, you would have the same purchasing power in your salary as you did the first year. As far as the merit pay and the step increases, well, if you work a job you know, you come into a job and you get paid a certain amount of money, after 10 years, you expect you're gonna get a raise, you know? Otherwise, you made a bad decision in getting that job, so. But and I have asked Paul Niswicki, the executive director, how his salaries compare with the private sector, and he assures me that they are, at least, they are no higher than the private sector. That's what he says. And he says in most cases they're lower. So, I mean, I have the same concerns over the commission's budget, because I don't think it gets the level of scrutiny that the rest of the budget does, but I'm not suggesting there's anything in there that anybody's doing anything wrong. But I'd like to see that whole discussion brought to the fore at the next budget cycle, when we look at all the salaries. So that's just my editorial comment on that.
Can I just respond?
Sure.
Just to speak up. I heard all three of you, and I'll speak for my fellow commissioners sitting next to me. We heard all three of you, and that's why when this was brought forth to us in March, we tabled it. We allowed our new administration and new staff to get on board and be able to review it. It's a very lengthy document. The review that the Cape Cod Commission paid for this reclassification did an excellent job, far better job than ours did when we had a group look at the county employees. So everything that you have mentioned has been considered, and again, as a person sitting in the position that we're sitting in, we had to rely on our staff who's reviewed this and move forward, and that's why we chose today to implement it. But all of your concerns, everything you guys mentioned, believe me, were equally felt at the commission's table too.
Ed, you have something?
Yeah, just to piggyback on what the speaker said, and I think what you're saying there also, commissioners, one of the things that I feel we don't do a good job of, when I say we, I mean the assembly, I'm not talking for the commissioners, is when we look at the various budgets, the salary levels, that there is no study that's given to us as to whether or not we're competitive or not competitive with similar type jobs. And in fact, we're not presented with most of the salary information unless we sort of like demand it, and it's very difficult to get. And I'm not saying anybody in the county is not being paid a fair salary or an unfair salary. I'm just saying, from a budget process, when we get to that, that's something that we should be looking at, as well as the programs that we look at, because salaries are probably 60-70% of the total budget, or maybe not that much in the county, but it's a high percentage.
All right, well, yes, Deborah.
I would like to add my voice to some of this discussion about salaries. I think that we live in a time now when people don't have a right, really, to expect significant salary increase every year. I think it's only in the public sector that you see salaries going up 6%, 7% every single year. It doesn't happen in the private sector. The private sector doesn't have that kind of money anymore. It doesn't have to pay it. And I think that we need to make our jobs competitive in a different way. And I just think that it ought not to be, well, we need to stop thinking that everybody has to have a raise of at least 3-5% every single year. It doesn't happen anywhere but in the private sector, in the public sector.
Okay.
Yes, go ahead.
I just want to respond on two things, just to kind of make you guys aware of it. As I mentioned earlier, the county did an assessment, and I'm not going to mention the company that did it, but we paid to have a classification study done, and things as Ed Lewis was talking about, you know, are we paying people fairly? And then the Cape Cod Commission hired a completely different firm. And I would ask all of you to get copies of both of those reports, and I think you'll find that the Cape Cod Commission's really did an excellent job. I also want to add to that, I know the first thing that you're probably going to feel, as I felt, is why doesn't the county go out and pay and have another one done? I don't think we have the money to do that, and I tell you, I as one commissioner, we have not spoken about this at the board level, but as one commissioner, I strongly feel that we don't need to do that at this time. We have enough information, we have new staff, we could probably do it in-house, And I believe if Jack's going to speak today, he'll probably allude to something that he's looking into along those lines. So just sometimes I think, and I know you're smiling, Ron, but you know, and I know Ed knows this, when you go out and you ask for these studies to be done, be careful what you wish for, because the information you get back may not be what you wanted. And I'll have to tell you, I think in this case, you did the right thing.
Julie, you're not leaving us, are you?
No.
Because we need you, you're a walking quorum right now.
Okay, well, let's
move to the voting issue then.
Okay, well, let's move it right along.
Yeah, well, I'm trying to do that, but I'm sorry.
We're done.
Support the resolution, the commission has did their own, by the way, just so you know.
Well, I could, but I think we're done here, except for we have a couple. We'll be done in 20 minutes.
Don't you have a public now?
As I suppress.
A minute.
Yeah, do we have communications from public officials? And then do we have any communications from members of the public? I see a member of the public. Communicate, please.
I come bearing gifts. I will be fast.
Thank you.
I turned it off, I'm sorry.
Elenita Muniz from the Human Rights Commission. I have brought you two things, and I just have one other heads up for you. The yellow report is the report of the Human Rights Academy for the projects of this year. The kids come to us in the spring and tell us the projects they've done over the course of the year. They're self-explanatory. I'll just say that many of them do raise money. Not all of them reported the amount they raised. But when I added up the amounts of the schools that did report it, it came to over $28,000, which went almost entirely to Cape Cod service agencies and programs. So over the course of the years that Cape Cod Academy's been doing their Shelter from the Storm concert, they've raised over $100,000, which has also gone into Cape Cod service agencies. So they're doing some pretty wonderful work, and we're quite proud of them. And thank you for supporting that. The Academy, we appreciate that. The second thing is the two new translations of our newest brochure. It's a general brochure about the Human Rights Commission, now available in Spanish and Portuguese, just from the printer, so we haven't gotten it distributed yet, but that is our next task. And we also have two other brochures on bullying and on filing a complaint that are also available in three languages. And we'll be working with George Hufelder to get the Zika virus thing translated as well. And the final thing is a heads up. On April 15th, we are putting on a conference on human rights and climate change. Brian's going to be facilitating one of the panels. Judith Blau, who's the commissioner who lives in Wellfleet, has been crisscrossing the Cape and has gotten a wonderful, powerful, enthusiastic response. It's going to be quite an interesting day. So more information will be coming, but just to let you know, mark your calendars on tax day. You can do something more fun than pay your taxes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. The assembly will now convene. We will bring up assembly vote on proposed resolution 16-05, support legislative efforts to resolve Monomoy refuge boundary dispute in Chatham. I submitted this. For those of you who were here last week, you know the commissioners, this was submitted to the commissioners and they approved it. To give you a quick heads up, the wildlife refuges were mandated by Congress to have management plans. This went back quite a while, I would think almost 10 years. So the management plans have been working their way through the system, and finally it was in the draft proposals, and the town of Chatham objected to some of the authority that was imposed on the Monomoy Wildlife Refuge that restricted fishing and other traditional activities out there. And there was an extensive negotiation process. We had some public hearings back and forth. And I would say that a lot of the issues were resolved, but the issue that was not resolved was that the Wildlife Refuge claims jurisdiction over areas below the low water mark. So if you're standing on the flats out in Nantucket Sound and you're looking over Nantucket Sound, they extend their authority beyond that into water that's never dry, low tide. And the implications of that are that traditional fishing methods, dragging for coho hogs, collecting mussels, there are trap grants out there, would come under the jurisdiction of the wildlife refuge. And Massachusetts, as you probably know, the state delegates authority over the activities, shell fishing activities and so on, to the towns to an extent of 3 miles. So that's really been the debate. They want to restrict it. We say no. These activities have gone on for a long time. They're part of the economic, the economic being of the town. And so they feel that this is the Wildlife Service, feels that they are mandated to do this by various acts of Congress over the course of time. So this is an attempt to submit legislation that will correct that and enable the town to maintain its authority, not over the whole area, but simply over certain traditional activities within that area below the low water, and to the extent that the wildlife refuge claims authority. So I don't know if you have any questions on that. Yes.
No, I was just going to move the resolution, put it
okay
on the floor.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Anybody? All right, we'll take a vote on it.
Yes.
Okay.
Ronald Bergstrom?
Let me see. I guess I'm for it. Yes. Yes.
Lillian Green?
Yes.
Christopher Kanega?
Yes.
James Killian?
Yes.
Edward Lewis?
Yes.
Suzanne McAuliffe?
Yes.
Deborah McCutcheon?
Yes.
Edward McManus?
Yes.
Brian O'Malley?
Yes.
Julia Taylor?
Yes.
Linda Zern?
Yes.
Mr. Speaker, proposed resolution 16-05 passes with 63.71% of the delegates voting yes, 36.29% are absent.
Thank you. There are no committee reports on this meeting. Committees have been in the back burner. Do we have anything from the clerk?
Nope.
Nothing from the clerk. Any other business?
Reminder that nomination papers are due Tuesday the 26th for anyone running for re-election. And also
to the town clerk.
Town clerk, and then you have to pick them up after they can check. And then the second thing is, with the publication of the lawsuit from Barnstable suing the county, there's been questions asked in my town, and I'm sure in other towns, of liability issues. So just to the executive and to the commissioners, I know they can't discuss things under liability, but maybe they just need to make a statement, because people are concerned about what they're going to be on the hook for. And we can't tell because it's under litigation.
Well, I don't know what the commission said. Unfortunately, when it goes to the lawyers, everything is done in executive session.
I know, like, so maybe we just need to issue a town statement to each town, just saying, it's in litigation, we don't have any answers at this point.
Okay, is that it? Or do you have a motion? Doc, did you have something?
I do, Mr. Speaker, and apropos of a lawsuit about the toxin in the water, this is just a follow-up report on Resolution 1603, which we passed May 18th with 67% in favor, that was petitioning the governor to deny the yearly operating plan for the permission to use herbicides. The clerk tells me that that went out to the governor's office the next day. On June 23rd, I called the governor's office and spoke with an aide, Rick BMA, said he would reach out and find out. Well, there's been no reach out, no find out. That's kind of how seriously we're taken up there. Just the other day, July 15th, MDAR approved Eversource's use of herbicides for its 2016 yearly operating plan. Interestingly, the only reference they cite in their decision as to how this was made, and I have that decision here, the only reference they cite is the plan submitted by Eversource. They appear not to have cited any other scientific references or any other opinions such as our petition. What this means right now is that the delegates from Bourne, Falmouth, Sandwich, Barnstable, Yarmouth, Dennis, Brewster, and Orleans, spraying may begin at any time. So there is a pushback. A number of communities have committed to challenge the approval. as aggrieved parties through the legal adjudicatory hearing process. Those being Eastham, Orleans, Brewster, and Dennis are each contributing $15,000 towards a legal fund. That will be heard, this case will be heard before the 13-member Massachusetts Pesticide Board. However, the truth is the Pesticide Board has never refused,
never
reversed MDAR in its decision. Legal counsel, some very, very good scientific testimony has been engaged. Attorney Bruce Taub from Orleans, who spoke to us here, will represent the towns. And I simply want to bring this to attention as a follow-up on decisions we made. Thank you.
They were there yesterday, Eversource.
Spring.
Not spring, getting ready.
One more, anybody else have a motion?
Go to adjourn.
Okay, second, all those in favor?
All right.
Okay.